We'll start. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Nidhi Sharma, and I'm working as a scientist at ISRO URSC. I welcome you all on behalf of ISSE, International Council on Systems Engineering, Bangalore Chapter, to this webinar. That's International Webinar on Systems Engineering Aspects of Artificial Intelligence in Robotics. ISSE fosters interdisciplinary collaborations in science and engineering. We attempt to promote mutual activities and collaborative efforts in system engineering. For today's webinar, we have the honor of being joined by Chairman ISRO and Secretary DOS, Dr. K. Shivan, Honorary Distinguished Professor ISRO and Chancellor IIST, Dr. B. N. Suresh, President ISSE National Governing Council and Director URSC ISRO, Shri P. Kunikrishnan, President ISSE Bangalore Chapter and Scientific Secretary ISRO, Shri R. Umamashek Maheshwaran, and Vice President ISSE Bangalore Chapter and Project Director Aditya Alvan Mission, Srimati Nigar Shaji, inaugurating this event. And a prominent bunch of national and international personalities as speakers who would be talking to us later today. As a mark of our undying tradition, we invoke the Almighty at the beginning of all important events. Keeping up with it, I'd like to invite Shivani Poddar from ISRO headquarters for a prayer to the Supreme Power within to give us inner strength to choose the right path in life. Krishna bhajana ko tene kahe je peed parai jaane re Krishna bhajana ko tene kahe je peed parai पर दुखे उपकार करे तो ये मन अभिमान लाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहे जे पीर पर आए जाने रे सकल लोक सहुले वंदे निंदा न करे तेनी रे वाच काच मन निश्चल राखे धन धन जननी तेनी रे वैष्णव जन तेने कहे जे पीर पर आए जाने पे समदृष्टि दे कृष्णा त्यागे पर स्त्री जेने मातरे जी पाथ की असत्य न मोरे पर धन न जरे आतरे वैष्णव जन तो तेने कहे जे पीर पर आए जाने रे थैंक यू वेरी मच शिवानी दैट वाज अ मेलोडियस मेलोडियस प्रेयर इंटरेक्शन एंड नॉलेज शेयरिंग अमंग वेरियस इंडस्ट्रीज एंड इंजीनियर्स इज इंस्ट्रूमेंटल टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ सिस्टम इंजीनियरिंग टेक्निक्स Such an interaction benefits us with an opportunity to learn about the challenges that the modern interdisciplinary system, like intelligent robotics in space, poses. We'd also learn about the ways in which others have succeeded at managing these complexities. I wish you all a great learning experience today. We will open the webinar with a welcome to our dignitaries, speakers for the day, and participants here today. I request Shri R. Umamaheshwaran, President ISSE, Bangalore Chapter, to kindly do the honors.
Dr. K. Shivan, Chairman ISRO, Secretary DOS. Dr. B. N. Suresh, sir. My dear Sri Kunjikrishnan, President ISSE and Director URSC. Srimati Nigar Shaji, Vice President ISSE Bangalore Chapter and Project Director Aditya Alvan, My seniors in and out of ISRO were all participants of this international program. My dear friends and colleagues from ISRO and other participants of this webinar. It is indeed an extremely happy moment for us, especially the ISSC Bangalore chapter today, to organize this international webinar jointly by ISRO and Indian Society of Systems for Science and Engineering on a theme which is very important and very relevant today. As you all know, ISSC is a professional body of interdisciplinary collaborations of systems in science and engineering with members comprising of scientists, engineers, academicians, research fellows, technical and scientific professionals from various R&D labs of India, academic institutions, state research institutions, and of course, the private industry. ISSC has a collaboration with INCOSE, that is International Council on Systems Engineering, to jointly explore opportunities in system engineering, collaborative efforts, and mutual promotion of activities. This international webinar on the theme System Engineering Aspects of Artificial Intelligence in Robotics was very carefully selected, considering its relevance in the context of system engineering and the topics that are going to be delivered by the respective domain experts from the leading space agencies and industries of the world. This would cover the entire gamut of artificial intelligence, robotic, and hence, obviously, the system engineering part. With this very brief introduction, let me go to my pleasant duty of welcoming the guests and the participants. Dr. K. Shivan, Secretary DOS, Chairman ISRO, requires no formal introduction to this audience. He is a very strong proponent of system engineering and supported all the activities of ISSC from the very beginning. He has kindly agreed to inaugurate today's webinar and deliver the inaugural address. I wholeheartedly welcome you, sir, for this webinar. Today, we are also honored with the esteemed presence of Dr. B.N. Suresh, Honorable Distinguished Professor, ISRO Headquarters and Chancellor, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology, Trivandrum, and the Chief Patron of ISSC. He has been indeed the true torchbearer of the systems concept and is our very respected and dear mentor as far as the system integration family is concerned. So a very hearty welcome to you, sir, for this inaugural session. Now coming to Sri P. Kunjikrishnan, the National President ISSC and the Director of URSC Center. Again, he is the leading light of ISSC and has been guiding us in planning such events. In fact, ISSC has now 12 chapters pan-India, and this has expanded in the last few years under the very dynamic leadership of our National President, Sri Kunjikrishnan. So a very hearty welcome to you, sir, for this inaugural function. I welcome Srimati Nigar Shahji, the Vice President ISSC Bangalore Chapter and Project Director Aditya Elvan, on all my ISSC office bearers of the Bangalore Chapter who has worked in and out in the last, 1 month to make this event happen in such a short span of time. Thank you very much, and let me welcome all of you personally. I also welcome all the speakers who has kindly consented to deliver these talks today. Let me tell you, this is truly an international seminar in the sense we have seven reputed speakers: Steve Chain from JPL, Dai Ashok from JAXA, Robbie Samantha Roy, Vice President Lockheed Martin, Alex Torre from CNES, and very recently we had Dr. Fauci Hani from Canadian Space Agency, apart from Sri Pratik Deshmukh of Robolab and Jagdish Mitra of Tech Mahindra. So it is a host of dignitaries who are going to talk on artificial intelligence in the context of system engineering, and it's a long day for us, but I'm sure it will be an exciting and informative day for all of us. So once again, let me welcome all the speakers who have agreed to deliver these talks. Finally, a warm welcome to all the participants who have shown the overwhelming response to our invitation to this program. I request you to kindly attend the full session, make use of it, and make this international meet a true success. Wishing you all good health, be safe, and a good day. Thank you all, and Jai.
Good afternoon, all. I welcome all the participants and the speakers back to this webinar, to today's second session. Hope everyone in India at least have rested and ate well during the break. Now let's start with the second session. During the first session, we had a very engaging talk about AI in space. This second session brings two Indian speakers from the industry talking about humanity aspects of AI and systems engineering culture. So let's listen from them. This session shall be moderated by Professor Sitaram Yaji. I take the pleasure of welcoming Professor Sitaram. He got his BTech degree in Electronics and Communication Engineering from NIT Suratkar and did his master's study at IISc. He has almost 25 years of industrial experience in various organizations like DRDO, ISRO, ITI Limited, Wipro Limited, Cisco Systems, San Jose, USA, and Cisco India. After leaving Cisco India, he became a freelance corporate trainer and did technical training for corporate engineers all over India for about 6 years. Since May 2015, he has been working as professor in Electronics and Communication Department in Neti Meenakshi Institute of Technology, Bangalore. His areas of interest include telecom, IP networking, VoIP unified communications, cellular core network, and embedded systems. He has published papers in IEEE conferences and also has a joint US patent in his kitty. I welcome you, sir. Pleasure having you on board, and over to you, sir.
So thanks for the introduction. And we are starting session two of this day-long virtual event. I welcome one and all for this session. And it is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Mr. Pratik Deshmukh. He is the co-founder and director, Robolob Technologies Private Limited, Pune, India. He holds Bachelor of Technology in Electronics and Telecommunications from Government College of Engineering, Pune. He is well-versed in executing technology projects and has deep knowledge on various industry methodologies. His vision is integral in maintaining Robolab's leadership in its key focus verticals and in making it one of India's best and most recognized technology services and business solutions provider. He's an expert speaker on entrepreneurship and leadership. He has several awards and recognition to his credit. He's the recipient of National Entrepreneurship Award given by Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, Government of India. He's also a Young Achiever Award from SIDBI. So this morning, you know, when our keynote speaker, Dr. B.N. Suresh, mentioned about introducing system engineering related things in academic world, and it is good we have Mr. Pratik talking about, you know, teaching pedagogies as it relates to system engineering, AI, and robotics. I welcome Mr. Pratik and request him to take over.
Thank you, sir. And good afternoon to all. It's a pleasure to be amongst you here. And when I was contacted regarding giving a talk on this topic, by the way, this is a wonderful topic that has been chosen. I made it sure that one of the really important things that is not talked about when we especially talk about systems engineering is how much it needs to penetrate inside a country, especially like India, for it to be very impactful and useful in the long run. So in today's session, I'll discuss about two, three things. Firstly, from the perspective of a student, I am, by the way, 28 years old. I graduated 7 years ago. I did my engineering in COAP College of Engineering, Pune, which is the third oldest college in Asia, established way back in 1854. I was lucky to be a part of the same college from where Dr. M. Vishveshwarya had graduated. Like, usually I tell people that I graduated and I am 130 years junior to M. Vishveshwarya, sir, from the same institute. One thing that really was striking to me when I was at COAP was the kind of atmosphere that we were lucky to have at the college. You won't believe there were 52 student managers that were totally taken care of by the students, managed by the students, not only in terms of management work, but also in terms of funds. So that was a good overall experience that I was lucky to have there. One of the things that we had in our college was a robotics lab, and I was a part of it for 4 years of engineering. And after graduation, I realized that robotics is the love of my life and I want to continue it further as a career. So instead of taking up the job that I got on campus, I, along with two, three of my friends, we decided to take up robotics as a career in the long run. At the same time, in CUAP, we also had a wonderful lab called as Fab Lab, where there were a group of students and some faculties who were working on creating a satellite right from the scratch. If you might not be knowing, that was one of the first satellites created completely by the students in the institute, which was launched by ISRO in 2016, when the project was completed. It took a complete duration of 10 years. The project was initiated by a student from civil engineering department who liked really working on satellites and was fascinated about it, and they completed that. So that is one aspect that I want to highlight today, that what we can give to the students, fraternity, to the institutes from the point of view of systems engineering, what we like from the point of view of industries and academicians, what we can do for them and help them out in terms of changing the way this subject is taught. Not many institutes cover it. So to set the tone of it, I'll start off with a small story, then I'll take you through a couple of examples of how we have tried to inculcate systems engineering in institutes, education institutes, especially talking about engineering colleges. If you might not be knowing, India has 3,500 plus engineering colleges, 10,000 plus technical institutes. The number of students who have access to technical institutes is a lot. We need to reach out to all of them. Third aspect would be from the point of view of how we can do and what we look up to it as future in terms of the contributions that could be given. So let me just share my screen. So I would like to start off with a very small story. The story is about a student and a faculty, his teacher. So the teacher had conducted an examination and the teacher wanted to access all the question papers. And in one of the question papers, he saw that one of the students had written an answer which he gave a 0 to, but the student was not happy about it and they had a quarrel. So the author is telling about that. So I'll just read out a small story for you first. So the story goes like this. Some time ago, I received a call from a colleague who asked if I would be the referee on a grading of a physics degree examination question at the University of Copenhagen. He was about to give a student a 0 for his answer to a physics degree. And the student claimed he should receive a perfect score and would if the system were not set up against the student. The instructor and the student agreed to submit this to an impartial arbiter and I was selected. So a classic example where a student is not happy with the marks that he got, and he wanted the faculty to give him the marks, and that's why they entered a quarrel and an arbiter was selected. I went to the colleague's office, read the examination question. The question was like, show how it is possible to determine the height of a tall building with the aid of a barometer. So we all know what a barometer is, something that measures pressure. The ideal answer to this question should be that you should take the barometer to the basement or the base of the building at the bottom of it, measure the pressure there, take it to the top of the building, measure the pressure there. You will see the difference in the pressures at the two places. And by calculating the difference and using simple formula, you can calculate the height of the building. The student had answered take a barometer to the top of the building, attach a rope to it, lower the barometer to the street, and then measuring the length of the rope. The length of the rope is the height of the building, which in fact pointed out that the student really had a strong case for full credit, since he had answered the question completely and correctly. On the other hand, if full credit was given, it would well contribute to a high grade for the student in the physics course. A high grade is supposed to certify competence in physics, but the answer did not confirm this. I suggested that the student have another try at answering the question. I was not surprised that the colleague agreed, but I was surprised that the student did. I gave the student 6 minutes to answer the question, with the warning that the answer should show some knowledge of physics. At the end of 5 minutes, he had not written anything. I asked if he wished to give up, but he said no. He had many answers to this problem. He was just thinking of the best one. I excused myself for interrupting him and asked him to please go on. In the next minute, he dashed off his answer, which read, "Take the barometer to the top of the building, over the edge of the roof, drop the barometer, timing its fall with a stopwatch. Then using the formula S is equals to UT plus half AT square, calculate the height of the building." At this point, I asked my colleague if he would give up. He conceded, and I gave the student almost full credit. On leaving my colleague's office, I recalled that the student had said he had many other answers to the problem. So I asked him what they were. "Oh yes," said the student, "there are great many ways of getting the height of a building with a barometer. For example, you could take the barometer out on a sunny day and measure the height of the barometer and the length of its shadow. And the length of the shadow of the building using a simple proportion determine the height of the building." So like using simple ratio and proportion, even the height of the building could be calculated, he said. "Fine," I asked, "and what are the others?" "Yes," said the student, there is a very basic measurement method that you will. If the skyscraper has an outside emergency staircase, it would be easier to walk up it and mark off the lengths of the skyscraper in barometer lengths, and then simply add them up, which is a very direct method which will give us the answer as well. "Of course," he said, "if you want a more sophisticated method, you can tie the barometer to the end of a string, swing it as a pendulum, and determine the value of G at the street level and at the top of the building. From the difference of the two values of G, the height of the building can be calculated." Finally, he concluded that there are many other ways of solving this problem. "Probably the best," he said, "is to take the barometer to the basement and knock on the superintendent's door. When the superintendent answers, you speak to him as follows: 'Mr. Superintendent, here I have a fine barometer. If you tell me the height of this building, I will give you this barometer.' So if you need help in life, the easiest thing is to go and ask for it." At this point, I asked the student if he really did know the conventional answer to this question. He admitted that he did. Said that he was fed up with high school and college instructions trying to teach him how to think using the scientific method and to explore deep inner logic of the subject in a pedantic way, as is often done in the new mathematics, rather than teaching him the structure of the subject. With this in mind, he decided to revive the scholasticism as an academic lark to the challenge the Sputnik panic classrooms of America. The student that we were talking about here was Mr. Niels Bohr. He was the first Dane ever to win the Nobel Prize for Physics. He proposed the orbital model that you see on the screen here. To your surprise, by the way, the second person who went on to win the Nobel Prize in physics, who was Dane, was again a Bohr, who was son of Mr. Niels Bohr itself. So this, in a summary, I think so, this story summarizes the way we presently teach in our education institutes, especially when we talk about engineering colleges. So systems engineering is something that is very much neglected. I'm not talking about the handful of the institutes like College of Engineering Pune, NITs, IITs, ISC, where students have these kind of opportunities, they have these kind of platforms available for them, but a lot of institutes, such kind of things are not available at all. That is one of the major things that we should talk about today and should try to resolve. When it comes to a discussion in terms of robotics, at why, firstly, if you, you know, go and talk to a student, he will ask you, "Why should I learn robotics, first of all?" So here usually somebody, some student asks that to me. I tell them that, you know, usually at one of the times I tell them a story about the head of departments of a particular engineering college. So there was a head of department from mechanical engineering, head of department from computer engineering, HOD from electronics engineering. And they all were sitting and started discussing that, hey, which branch is the most important of all branches? What branch can be as the mother of all branches? So the computer people started saying that, hey, without us, you can't even order food nowadays. You can't have a cab without us. You can't talk on WhatsApp without us. So we are the mother of all branches. We are the most important branch of all. Mechanical people started saying that, hey, this is all rubbish. Without us, none of the machines, none of the cars, none of the huge, huge lifts that you use would be existing. So mechanical is the mother of all branches. Electronics people at the same time started arguing. Electronics HOD started saying that, hey, without me, you can't communicate with each other. You cannot give a call. You cannot even have space exploration if communication didn't exist at all. So I believe that electronics is the mother of all branches. And they all started getting into a huge quarrel. And in that quarrel, that got really nasty. And after some time, robotics walked in. And robotics said that, hey, stop all this. I am robotics and mother of all branches. So I need the best of all technologies, all departments to come together so that I could exist. This, in nutshell, is something that we need to teach to our students, that there is the need of the day is to have engineers who will be jack of all trades and at least master of some. And for that to happen, we have to ensure that we have to inculcate in them the basics of systems engineering through various ways that we can think of. One of the best ways which I personally find useful, especially for students, is to participate in group competitions. Like one of the competitions, there's a competition called RoboCon, which is held every year. The beauty of RoboCon is that there is a problem statement which is released in the month of August every year. And this problem statement is common to students, undergraduate students from countries of about 15 countries, 16 countries who participated in it. All the good colleges in India, say all the IITs, NIITs, all the autonomous institutes, they participate in it. Last year, about 150 colleges participated. And there is a period of 6 months given for every college to prepare a solution for a problem statement that is given. And on the day of the examination, on the day of the competition, all the robots, all the teams come together and they are able to see what the other institute, other students who had the same time, same problem statement, same knowledge that was given to us in terms of the requirement. What are the solutions that they have built up? So it is a very good eye opener. And it is also very good in terms of knowing that how you work as a team, which really matters when you work in the industry in the long run. I myself have participated in RoboCon for 3 years of engineering, and it was a wonderful experience. And it was because of being a part of RoboCon that we decided that, hey, there is a good group of friends who are interested in robotics can work together, and we went on to start up the company later on. In the previous talks today, one of the major thing that Mr. Steve and a friend from Japan pointed out is that system engineering really helps us in planning a good roadmap. So planning a good roadmap, I think so, it's not only just a managerial perspective, but also a good technical input goes into it in terms of the development of things. Usually, if you think from the point of view of an engineering college student, whenever they want to do a project, usually what they do is they do a Google search, they find out something fascinating. So here's one of the example, one of the students, he found something fascinating in one of the institutes that I worked with. I have had the pleasure to visit more than 170 colleges personally and closely working with 50 plus institutes. So everywhere we go, and if you empower students with the platforms, they tend to come up with wonderful ideas. So this was one of the ideas that the student came up with. He said that, I want to create a replica of human hand. We asked him really basic questions that, hey, do you know how complex a human hand is? If you don't know, a human hand is the most complex device in terms of mechanisms in human body. A single hand has 26 bones in it which coordinate with each other for enabling us to pick up or grasp something with a particular force. So they decided, since we cannot complete the entire thing, we cannot replicate the entire hand in one go, since there was a time constraint as well, let us do a smaller version of it. So instead of the hand, let us try to create a finger first. So they created a finger. They first created a replica of it. The way they did it is they simply used normal acrylic, which is a kind of thermosetting plastic. They laser cut it, designed it first, trying to replicate the size of the finger. And with the help of a normal, and see here, this is a normal 6-volt servo motor that most of the students use in engineering colleges. They connected with the help of a string to the horn of the servo motor. So as the servo motor's horn moves, the finger is pulled down. So when they were able to do it for one hand, they decided that, hey, when they were able to do it for one finger, they decided they use 5 servos, one for each finger. They used a basic controller like 128. This is which was interfaced with the flex force sensor. So this that you see here, this sensor is called as flex force sensor, which is kind of a resistance. Its resistance changes. This change in resistance is converted into change in voltage with the help of a voltage divider arrangement here, which further gives voltage to the analog to digital converter, which is present in the controller. And in the process, they utilized servo motor by interfacing it with the controller. They were able to understand the basics of how to generate a PWM pulse to rotate a servo, interface this in real time, and they were able to perform this in the first go. After this, they also ended up writing a paper on it, and usually, as happens in engineering colleges, they completed their engineering and they went off. So that project got stalled there. We thought that if we really want to do some long-term work education institutes, we cannot just depend on people. We need to follow a very good system-centric approach. We cannot just keep it as person-centric. So we decided that whatever project has been done in one college, why not tell other institutes about it? So we ended up telling about this project to another institute. And it took us a couple of years to find somebody from another institute who would be interested to studying that pre-done work that was already done, and decided to compress that entire project into a small. So this was the second version created by the students. The arm is same, and they decided, since these were from electronics department, they decided we will make the electronics a bit more compact. And so this robot is a bit more compact. It is more energy efficient. It works faster than the previous one. The next batch of students from another institute said that, hey, why do we have to keep it, operate it only with the help of a glove, which is wiredly connected? Why can't we make it such that it could be wireless? So the next batch of students decided to make it wireless. They use the same sensors. Instead of directly connecting with the help of USART communication, they decided, why not use a module like Bluetooth or ZigBee or NRF. So they ended up doing the next phase, which went on like this. Mind you, these are students who are from second year and third year of engineering. They had the resources with them and they ended up doing it. The next batch of students, they said that, hey, why can't we make it gesture based? So you must be aware about a thing called deep motion sensor. So some students started working on that and they made it gesture based. By this time, we had entered into a collaboration with a wonderful company called as Dassault Systems. So wherein we decided that they offer online module which they called as 3D Experience, which offers systems engineering in it. So we started thinking and we started involving students in system engineering, which ultimately, you know, made us understand that it is something which will not only cover the technical aspects of this project, that something has been going on for about 4 years it took for this project to come from the wired way to the wireless way. How can we improve it in future? How can we, you know, fast track this growth that took 4 years for this project to happen? What can we do into it? So we decided that we do system engineering into it. And we realized that this systems engineering can give students 21st century skills. they will be able to create a good roadmap of the work that they are doing. In the process, they will, you know, ultimately as students face a lot of challenges, but they will learn to accept it and build on skills. That when you working objective at some point don't fail. It is okay to succeed, it is okay to fail as long as you do it as a team. The ultimate goal that we have seen students achieve out of involvement of systems engineering is to foresee the things that happen or that might happen, and that has helped them in better decision making. So this time, when the new group of students whom first approached from systems engineering perspective decided that we will do it from a perspective where we will first analyze what we are going to create, see, test it in even in hardware in the loop, and if it goes well, then we will go for the manufacturing perspective of it. Yeah, it is as it is rightly said, failing to plan is planning to fail. So we teach that to the students when they work on any project in it. So they started off with a very basic thing. Quadcopters are really popular in engineering colleges. Students work a lot on it. So whenever a quadcopter is used and there are BLDC motors at the end of it with propellers, every time a quadcopter flies, there are forces that it generates on the four wings that it flies on. So we decided that let us start off with redesigning a quadcopter. How can we understand the forces and the trusses that work on it? So this was for very initial projects, which we did on the platform called as 3D Experience. And there is a thing called as digital twinning. So a digital twin is like if you are creating any robot or a system or a working something that moves, you can create first a digital module of it as well, and you can interface it in real time with an existing module. So once we were able to do this, and once we were able to see how it works, so students were able to decide that, hey, if we could give trusses to these part, this quadcopter will last longer. So with such basic thing, they decided to take up the existing project, which was done with a, you know, kind of a Jugado attitude that, hey, there is a finger, I want to move it, let's just swing it. Calculation. So they decided to interface it in real life, and this is how they did it. They created a digital twin of it first. We call this robot as Flexo, the robot hand. And the beauty of the digital twin is that you can have it in the hardware. This is based on basic Arduinos, and you can interface it in real time with the software that is present here. So once you do that, you get a hell lot of good numbers in terms of the values of the fingers. It helped them select the right kind of material that they should utilize to manufacture this. It helped them what should be the distance of the links, what should be the thickness of the links, what kind of material to be used. And most importantly, we believe the ultimate aim of technology is to make the end products more ergonomic for themselves. So this group of students who worked on this, by utilizing this, by doing proper stress and breaking point analysis, they decided that instead of using acrylic 2D manufactured part, let us use 3D printed parts with a material that is flexible. So the present hand that has been made is 3D printed completely, and it was possible only because of integrating systems engineering in it. Another group of students who were really interested in working on an industrial robot, they approached their college and said that, hey, we want to work on an industrial robot. Usually in India, institutes spend a lot on inviting a good singer, like let's say Arjit Singh, to their campus, and will spend lakhs on it for a single night. But they are a bit skeptical when it comes to spending on creating a good platform or infrastructure for the students. So that, hey, if you cannot give us the industrial robot, create one on ourselves. So they worked on this platform, created a digital twin of the robot first. So what you saw initially was an example of integrating the virtual robot that they created with the real one. At the same time, they were also able to do the vice versa of it. Whatever they created in the real world, they could map the virtual world. It's like having a teach pendant, but something that will create data, and that data will help you to create a better design in future. This that we saw here in data was also applied to that Flexo robotic hand. Some students said that instead of just giving it to a person, why not make that glove intelligent? So what they did is they decided to use some AI into it. Every time if a person's, if different people wear that glove, every finger sizes would be different. So we need to recalibrate that system every single time before we use it. So instead of that, they made it such that every time you wear it, it recalibrates itself. And the more time the glove spends, the man, the human who is wearing it spends with the glove, the more familiar the system gets with him, the more calibrated it gets, and the better motion it is able to produce. And once they, some people, you know, worked on this digital twinning thing, they decided to take it to the next level, and they ended up doing a project like this. So Ganpati is really popular in India. So they used a couple of robots and performed aarti with the help of it. This is the same that you saw, 4-axis one with a parallel link gripper. And this went really viral. And the students who did it, they ended up getting wonderful jobs and doing good work in their life right now. Apart from such kind of things that students are get capable of doing with them, started analyzing that, hey, if some people in India, some students in India can do it, why can't others? So the main differentiating factor that we formed, that we found out, was in the form of a kitchen. It is said that if you want to eat a good dish, you should have a good kitchen for that. So we look up to the labs in India in the form of kitchens. We believe that if you provide a good kitchen to somebody, if you teach them how to cook, give them all the ingredients, they will never die hungry. Similarly, the kind of labs that we give and we make our students work in, they need to be revamped a lot. We need to, you know, rethink about. We believe that a lab should be like a mother. As a mother provides everything that a child needs, a lab should have all the technological know-how under a single. It should literally be a place where people can walk in with ideas and walk out with working models. The it is, as I said initially, robotics is the daughter of all branches. So we need to involve people, to involve technologies like pneumatics, since it is very widely used in industries, vacuum technologies, which is in pick and place operations at a lot of places, quadcopters, some production systems, not only based on basic controllers or things like Raspberry Pis. We need to move industrial oriented things at the institutional level when students are learning, like PLCs and SCADA things. We need to empower them with things like industrial robots at the institutional level, so that by the time they graduate, they have a good idea of what goes on in the industry. Usually a lot of times when big companies hire people, they spend a lot of time in making the engineers ready for deployment. So that time would be reduced if we follow the systems engineering approach in it. Any time, you know, if you talk to an education institute and you talk to them about investing, a lab, they'll think up to it that how is it going to be useful for us. So we need to ensure that all our institutes have a well-defined return on investment from the educational perspectives for every lab that they work on. Nowadays, most of the institutes have labs wherein the only outcome that they require is the completion of the syllabus. We need to change that. We need to tell the institutes that if you are having a good mother lab kind of a thing, there should be some key performance indicators, like what are the number of research papers that are done, what are the number of patents that the lab is able to produce. There should be at least a couple of entrepreneurs coming out of the lab with projects. Presently, a lot of thing is talked about Atmanirbhar Bharat. So that is possible only if we give a system integrated approach at the educational level to them and empower them with the right knowledge so that they can come up with the right ideas. So this at my institute, good things happen, already happening. But at other colleges that you must have, might not have gone, students are really, you know, not aware of what are they going to do in their 4 years of engineering. They just start doing their engineering, and if they come across a facility like this, a mother lab like this, they don't have a roadmap of what they're going to do there. So it is very important to create a good roadmap of what a student can do in such kind of a facility, from first year of engineering to what they can do in second year, in third year, and in fourth year. A first year thing can be as basic as being an apprentice. Like even when in our college, when I entered the robotics lab in first year, my senior, even though I was an electronics and telecommunication graduate, the first task given to me was to cut the wooden parts for the robot that we were manufacturing. So that gives a very good overall approach. Secondly is, as I pointed out, a system-centric approach at the institute. Things, and especially labs like these, shouldn't be dependent only on the faculties. It should be something which should be driven by the students directly. The way to do it is to give confidence and put faith in the students, give them access 24/7 to the labs. Not every institute in India does it. Very handful of the institutes have given full-time access to the labs. If we give the access to the labs and give faith to the students, they will have a sense of belongingness. They will be able to contribute back more to the lab in the long run. Even after they graduate, we have seen students coming back to their alma mater and just helping out their juniors, because once upon a time they were a part of the lab and that helped them in the long run. In terms of the role of artificial intelligence that we have seen, people and students have utilized these robotic platforms as implementation platforms that they use to apply their algorithms. Some of them always, you know, people from computer department, especially students, they are not interested in building up a robot. They will usually say that, hey, give us a robot that can perform X, Y, Z things. We will create an algorithm and we will apply to it. But when it comes to creating something right from the scratch, it is important, especially when we are doing work in an organization, let's say like ISRO, you cannot say that, hey, I will not look into the mechanical aspect of it. I will only work about, I will only think about the computer aspect. You need to know all the things that are going on in order for the end product to work on. So especially AI has been utilized from that aspect in a lot of projects. Ultimately, we think and we believe that the aim of AI should be to teach our students to make humans free and to let them perform the tasks that a robot cannot. And a lot of time, you know, nowadays a lot of us are working from home on the computers. The human aspects of human is missing. So AI can give that aspect back to us. The technical things, I believe, could be learned. You can teach that to them in the process. One of the aspects that we believe we have to inculcate in students when we are teaching them is to follow a very good task-based approach. Institutes in India presently do it. So this is one of the problem statements that we gave to a group of students in one of our labs. We told them to create a robot that was able to detect fire, go towards it and extinguish it. We didn't tell them the way they should approach it. They started thinking about various solutions. One of the things they came up with, basic things like, of course, a robot should have mobility, it should have water to extinguish. So they decided to use the pumps from cars that are used in the windshields of the car to clean it. Then came detection of the fire. So somebody was very good at MATLAB. He said that, hey, I can, you know, write a code, have a camera, and if there is a fire in front of it, it will be able to detect it and extinguish it. Then some other students said that, hey, even if you're able to detect fire, how are you going to align yourself in front of it so that you are able to extinguish it? Some of the students started working on the MATLAB perspective, and they created a solution where they were able to detect fire. Some of the faculties just took a photograph of fire and put it in front of it, and it was also detected as fire itself. So at that point, whatever work the student had done in a period of about 2 months, that all went in vain. They started thinking about other solutions. Some people said that let's work with the help of an infrared camera. Then the cost perspective came into picture, that it is too costly for a project, a BTech project, to have an infrared camera in it. So they started thinking about a lot of things, and somebody then suggested that why not use a 5 rupee IR sensor that will be able to detect fire. So they designed a circular sensor board that had 8 sensors on it, IR sensors, which was able to detect the fire, and it was mounted such that you could align with the help of it. And they ended up doing this. After doing this, somebody told that, hey, what if you take it in sunlight? Don't you think it is going to fail? because sunlight also has IR waves, and they realized that whatever project that they had, you know, completed and published, it will not work in sunlight. So such kind of things do happen if you don't take the entire picture into consideration. And I think so systems engineering, teaching it at college level will be really helpful in such kind of things. One of the aspects when it comes to teaching students industrial automation, I think so systems engineering is really helpful in that perspective as well. This is one of the cases wherein we gave students a problem statement that, hey, you have two kinds of objects, metallic and non-metallic. You have to distinguish between these objects with the help of some sensors that you want to use. If it is metallic, then you have to perform a drilling operation. If it is non-metallic, don't perform a drilling operation. And I told them you have to use pneumatics in it, you have to use vacuum technology in it, and you have to use a conveyor in it. So this is what we ended up creating. So here, that the first part that you saw is pneumatic cylinders, which takes up with the help of reed switches, which gives feedbacks to the PLC. This yellow one is a plastic object. This red one is a metallic object. The plastic object, when it comes in front of the color sensor, it will be able to detect the color. Even with the color sensors, when students actually started working on it, they faced a lot of problems. After detecting the color, it is communicated to this small robot. This is the same robot that you saw, the digital twinning, and the one that was utilized for RP. So they came across this robot and they had all the database of the work done by the past people, and they utilized it on this small project for doing it. This other one, the red colored one, is metallic. So drilling operation was performed and it will be segregated as metal and red color. I was telling you about the colors and part. So one of the interesting things that happened while sensing color was every time the light intensity used to change, the values of the color used to change. So they tried out a lot of things. Then they decided that why not use an array of white lights to keep the light in. They were able to reduce the effect of the ambient light in it. So such kind of things, if you give them in the form of problem statements in which you can control a platform wherein you can, you know, deviate from the mean things and tell the students to try to resolve the issues, such kind of task-based approach can be really helpful. We believe that students are like resources, especially when they work in an atmosphere like a lab or on a project. We have to tell them, we have to ensure that they understand that somebody after them is also going to work on that project. So there should be proper handshaking of knowledge, handshaking of work from one person to another, which we need to inculcate that in the institute level itself, so that by the time they go in the industry, they are better equipped to work in an system, in a system where a lot of people work together for a bigger thing. And of course, we ensure that if they are doing any work, that should be patented. In India, usually people are not much aware about it and they end up losing a lot of their work, good efforts that they've already done. Out of this approach, wonderful outcomes have come up. Some of the students did a project on pneumatics-based pick and place operation. So every time in every lab that we have done in India, we keep an open day. So on the open day, all the nearby industries and students and entrepreneurs are allowed, the parents of the students are allowed to come and see what their students have, what their kids have done in the lab itself. So there was a small-scale industry that manufactured papad. So papad is circular and plain object that usually we Indians eat by roasting it or by frying it. So one of the important processes in papad manufacturing is after you make it plain, you have to apply oil on it and then stack it. So this was something which was manually done by that manufacturer. He just saw that project and he said to the students, hey, can you automate this part for us? And these students took it up as a project. They ended up completing that project along with, by involving their institute and the company, and by using their same project, just modifying it, they ended up completing it. It was a win-win situation for the students and for the faculties and for the manufacturer as well. At the same time, one of the parents who had visited in one of our other labs on one of the open days, he was from working in Indian military. He went on to his military base and told his friends about how students are learning automation, robotics, systems engineering at college. We as Indian officers, we don't have much knowledge about it. A lot of times, a lot of people who are into Indian military, Navy or Air Force, they have a mechanical background. So they are not much aware about the electronics and automation and AI aspects of it. So they invited us and got in touch with us and said that, hey, can you come and give us a training on that? So we ended up getting involved with them, which later went on to a lab establishment with them. So this is the one of the batch of the officers of the Indian Navy that we trained at Military Institute of Technology, which is in Girinagar, Pune. So all these are sub-lieutenant and lieutenant level officers who work on field and on field or on the ships. So before they are sent to the ships, they have to learn about hydraulics, pneumatics and automation, which they have started to learn in the customized curriculum that we have created to them. And it has been a very good addition for them. The best thing that I heard from their mouth was that our fear of automation and electronics has gone out. We can now, you know, at least debug small things if it comes in front of us. So that is the beauty of systems engineering. Even if you are not able to empower somebody with the A to Z knowledge of it at institute, you can help a mechanical engineer become capable enough to do small debuggings, which especially in scenarios like the Indian military and Navy can be life-saving things. So these are some of the trainings that we conducted there. This is the Indian Navy people. This officer that you see right here is seeing an LED for the first time in his hand, and he went on to learn about how AI and different algorithms can be used to do four-wheeled omni-wheeled robots. When you use four omni-wheeled robots, omni-wheels are wheels that can go in any direction. You have to have a good mathematical model to operate it. So they went on to learn the generic working of it in the training itself. Later on, we also gave training to them on the automation PLC perspective of the same system that I showed to you, miniature industrial production system. We have seen is wonderful. Officers have started to take up projects on robotics, and we believe that involvement of systems engineering, even to these people who are already working on field, will be very useful in the long run. Some, especially when the lockdown happened, some of the institutes approached us and asked us that, hey, can you do something for the patients in hospitals? It was lockdown everywhere in Pune. I live in Pune, so Pune is really affected right now. Since we were in lockdown, we couldn't, you know, meet each other. So we started working on the virtual platforms, and with the help of designing tools, analysis tools, we were able to create this system, which we called as a Corona Warrior robot. And it was developed in 1 month. We involved a couple of institutes whom we work with into this. So the students were really seeing that they are able to contribute back to the society and carry food, carry water and the medicines for the patients. And it is presently, we have deployed a couple of isolation centers in Pune. And patients have been able to, you know, talk to their loved ones also, because this also has a small camera. You can also see a feed of the camera. And that, you know, kind of jugaad that we Indians say. So they took up a camera that is available. They interfaced it with their present Raspberry Pi, and they took the entire data, sent it on the internet, and they were able to communicate the patient with their loved ones over the phone itself. Now, presently, in terms of what we are doing as a country, are we headed in the right direction when it comes to teaching students about systems engineering? I believe yes, we are. In India, there is a body called as All India Council for Technical Education, AICT, which is presently doing a phenomenal job. They have recently introduced the new education policy, which I believe is a master stroke. But even as a masterstroke, I think so. Education execution is something that is really going to matter in the long run. The way AICT approached this was, first they identified 9 areas of emerging technologies. Out of them, 2 were artificial intelligence and robotics. And these are the other areas that they identified, including IoT, blockchain, and everything. I believe all of them needs, they form the backbone of the future systems engineering that we are going to work in, because all of these things are going to come in industry, they are going to come in our day-to-day lives in near future. And this is a very good step by the Government of India and AICT. A good thing that has been done in the past, I believe in the past few months, is that if in the past you went to a particular vendor and said that, hey, I want to learn artificial intelligence, give me a lab. So everybody used to have their own versions of the lab, but now that has stopped. Government and AICT has released their curriculum, sample curriculum. I'll just share it with you. So AICT has released a document where they had said that what are the contents, if somebody is trying to learn artificial intelligence, what are the learning outcomes that should come out of it. So that has been very wonderfully defined in terms of theory and in terms of practical. So if somebody decides to learn artificial intelligence, even as an elective, they know what they should learn. And it will be really helpful to us as a country in the long run. At the end, I would like to, like, this is also one of the things developed by the student. This is a smaller version of the Mars rover robot. Some people were interested in the Curiosity robot launched by NASA. So they made a smaller version of it on campus itself. It has a camera which could be interfaced with a TV tuner, and you can see the feedback on your laptop or your TV. At the end, I believe that every student in India is like a flint. A flint is a stone that if you rub, you can generate fire. So there is a very beautiful poem that I used to have in fourth standard, which read like this, that an emerald is as green as grass, a ruby red as blood. A sapphire shines as blue as heaven, a flint lies in the mud. A diamond is a brilliant stone to catch the world's desire. An opal holds a fiery spark, but a flint holds fire. So nowadays, all the students are very much interested in going behind the emeralds, rubies, and sapphires, because, you know, like, they don't know how important the basics can be. So a thing like flint, as it is lying in the mud, it might not look that you know, helpful, but if you take two flints and rub them together, it can produce fire. And we all know how important fire has been for human beings till now. So that's it from my end. There is another small story about good set of work that some of the students ended up doing for the Indian BSF force in West Bengal. So that I would like to show you. So there was a group of, as I said, that we have open day in colleges. So one of the faculties, one of the parents who visited in one of our labs, he went on to his hometown and he had done, he had invited us to give a training to their military regiment. We had given the training to them. Then that person went on to work on the Indian border. So there was some issue in between India and China, and the Chinese people used to infiltrate in India in Doklam. This was in sometime in August 2017. So there was a system that Indian officers used to use for surveillance. That system was to be operated. It was about 5 feet tall tripod on which there was a camera was present, about 1000 mm lens of the camera was present to operate camera. That camera had night vision in it. To operate that, the person had to stand next to it with a laptop kind of a device. And there was only a wire of 2 meters. So a couple of Indian officers were shot by Chinese snipers while standing next to the camera. So they came up with the problem statement that, hey, can we make it such that it could be operated from a bunker about 150 meters away? And they requested us, can you... And he decided that this could be done in the form of automation. So he got in touch with us and said that, hey, can you automate this? Because we have only 2-3 days. We cannot procure a new one because procurement takes a lot of time in Indian systems. So they sent the entire system from West Bengal to our Pune office. We ended up working on it. And within 5 days, we were able to make a solution where that entire thing could be operated with the help of a new control box that we made. All the audio, video feed could be taken, and with the help of buttons, they could operate it. So this literally ended up saving the lives of the officers. Such kind of things are possible if we empower our students with the right platforms, with the right knowledge. And I believe that systems engineering with a good pinch of robotics and AI can be the wonderful platform to do it. That's all from my end. Any questions from you, I'll be happy to answer.
Yeah, thank you very much, Pratik. See, there are over 300 plus attendees attending this session. I am sure there is a good representation from academic world, and there were excellent inputs both for students and faculty who are attending this session, especially the stress on projects and the way they should be done, where the system engineer in concept should be applied, then the other things like digital twinning, and you mentioned one point, right? A batch of students does a project and then they leave the college and the project
that usually happens.
That is really not good. And very good inputs from you. Currently, though I come from industry, currently I am in academic world. Excellent inputs. And I have one question. See, robotic applications, okay? Can you give, two or three applications where AI versus no AI would make a significant difference?
So there is a good project that we got from one of the DRDO based organization, which was taking an object, and it was taking up a material which was kind of inflammable, taking it up and putting it inside a device and then locking that up. They wanted to automate that task, and they said that, hey, we will use AI into it, we will try to have a camera, we will try to see with the help of camera where that is, kahan pe wo gir raha hai, where the powder is going there or not. But when they tried to implement it, they were not able to give that human touch to it. And since it was inflammable, even a small, even a pinch of it, if it caught fire, the entire thing would have caught fire. So instead of using AI in such kind of situations, it's always better, because we are not yet, haven't yet reached a level where you can rip human being directly in this case. So this was one of the examples where I found that rather than using a robot, it is always an intelligent system. It is always used good to do it with the help of a human being.
Okay. And one question from the attendees, how to connect with RoboLab for project purpose?
Sure. Just a second. My last slide had my communication phone number on it. If you could just enable screen sharing once again, I can share that. So we have already established 48 such labs in India till now. We have a very open culture in terms of keeping all the labs connected. So one lab can have a student exchange program with other as well. So there is a very good open culture available. So this is my email ID and the contact number.
And I guess the same thing can be got from a website also, right?
Yes. The website robolab.in. We have wonderful resources available. I myself have been an outcome of being a part of a good robotics culture that we had at our college. When I was in college, I never took seriously doing the projects. I was always interested in participating in competitions, but as you work in industry, you realize how important it is to publish the work, to own the work in the form of patenting that you do. If you really want to help others, make sure that you have the rights to do it. So doing projects is really important, especially as students. Faculties, they know this, but students usually don't listen to them when they say that do projects rather than just doing competitions.
Okay, I thank you very much on behalf of ISSC for an excellent talk. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Pratik.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It was a pleasure talking to you all.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.